Welcome. It's great to see you all here. I know some of you have been traveling in from far away, so it's good to see you. Today, this is DevOps Oxford. We kind of asked ourselves what configuration management is good for. And I'll show you a little bit more what I mean by that and why we started thinking about this. But first, I want to introduce our sponsors. So food and drink provided by Rekiva. Thank you very much. And Oxford Trust is offering us this very nice space. So I looked up configuration management, my trusted source, Wikipedia. So it's actually is a real thing that people use. It's a systems engineering process that used to establish and maintain consistency of your product's performance, functionality, and physical attributes, and operational information throughout its life. And this is the thing that tech people love doing. So we take this word that someone else has already used and defined, and then we redefine it for something that sounds good. Because there's actually no really good definition of this that I could find anyway for computer systems. But it's about this consistency. I like that. That really sounds like why I would use a configuration management tool. And then there's the modern developer who says, everything's in Docker now, so why would I worry about the system? I don't need that stuff anymore. And when I write my infrastructure as code, I need this dependency graph, so I use Terraform. And for everything else, I can just write the script. So we want to find out what is this really, and what is it good for? Because I think we find these new tools, we tend to forget what the existing tools are actually used for and why we need them. So to help us answer that question and many others, Mandi is here, Technical Community Manager at ChefSoftware. Welcome.
Thank you for the introduction. Thanks for coming tonight. So I kind of titled this talk, Configuration Management is Old and Boring, as it feels like everybody asks us, you know, why are we still doing this? Why are you still selling this stuff? Nobody uses that anymore. You don't need it. So I am Mandi Walls. I am the Technical Community Manager for Europe at Chef. If you're part of the Chef community, I work for the famous and infamous Nathan Harvey. So I don't have to dress up in costumes and get thrown eggs in my face or any of the other weird things that he has to do because he's a vice president and I'm not. On social media, I am LNXCHK. Feel free to tweet at me. I'll put the slides out later. They'll also be on the meetup page. A lot of the things we end up doing that we've been doing for the past several years at Chef, we started out as a configuration management tool. That's our primary product that we sell to people that have money, right? And they give us money and it's great. And then as part of that transition into using configuration management, we got involved in the DevOps ecosystem and that whole DevOps transformation and all the things that people do. A couple of years ago, I wrote a white paper for O'Reilly called Building a DevOps Culture, based on some of the projects that we had done, moving folks from sort of older IT to newer IT along the way. So if you follow our, I have a column on my Twitter for Chef, right? And most of it's our stuff, but every now and then there's something really delicious that pops up there because somebody like pulls us into their thread using the wrong tags or whatever. But that's fun. So yeah, on the IT side, there's never really been a standard. There's some academic research and there's some other things, but you know, there were a whole lot of different products that did things a bunch of different ways, and even if we had like a big conference on configuration management to sort of settle it once and for all, we'd probably bifurcate it further. So we play in a space where it's us and Puppet and our sort of grandparent was CF Engine and Mark and the work that he had done in academic space there, and then sort of the follow-ons being sort of Ansible and Salt and whatever else people sort of come up with in the meantime. So 1 minute history of configuration management, right? Back in the back annals of time, right, there were a few very, very expensive computers, and the people who were operators operated them and configured them for the specific programs that they were designed to run for. Then there was this Cambrian level explosion of technology where not only did it come for the consumer side where you had like awesome stuff like the Atari 2600 and Pong, but also all these home computers and all these things that people could do with them. You still had all these business machines, they still had to be useful, whether they was a VAX or digital Unix or whatever, into the things that we sort of have now with Gen 2 and whatever other bizarre Linuxes people run. And along the way, all kinds of tools were written to help with all this stuff. So every platform sort of had its own specialization for packaging and managing software, different tools for managing users. Along the way, the GNU tools sort of came in and tried to like tamp down all of the bifurcation that happened there. They won a little bit, but not all of it. There's still weird stuff out there. And you know, it's not really the end. Like, it just continues to be larger and larger. We still get asked, can I put Chef on my mobile devices? I have tablets, can I manage those with Chef? Like, we wish, because that would be buku dinero, but it's just not the way that things are going. The way businesses are going, though, every business is a software business, and we talk to a lot of enterprises now about their IT practices, the things they want to get out of technology, the work they want to be able to do with technology, as well as sort of other organizations that are doing interesting things. There's like different disruption that happens in different parts of different marketplaces, and whether that's good or bad or Uber or not, that sort of, you know, that sort of drama happens, but also in the same position where you're putting technology in the hands of people who've never had access to it before, because the infrastructure has changed, it's now wireless. It doesn't have to be telephone poles run through the bush to get access to people in the Amazon or sub-Saharan Africa. So there's a lot of things to do there. For those of us in the West, we have a lot of companies where I can talk to them from a device in my pocket, and there's so much other work that gets done. We had Alaska Airlines, which is a regional airline in the US, but it's based very close to our headquarters in Seattle. And their CIO did a talk for us at our last conference, and he basically said, you know, we want, you know, when an airplane lands, we want the door open in 60 seconds. And you get there by using technology and figuring out where your bottlenecks are, what things are slowing you down, where all of these things can be tweaked and fixed and twisted and all that, as well as all the components that go into just getting on an airplane and having a customer experience flying. So you get to a point where they're going to be a software company with airplanes, and they have these large capital expenses, they have these huge machines, but at the same time, to have the good customer experience, it all comes down to software. So being able to run the things that they need to run and run them well, run them consistently, still comes back to configuration management. A lot of stuff changed, right? There's a lot of the companies that we talk to, technology is increasingly becoming a core competency. And what we saw, there was an article in Harvard Business Review, 2005, I want to say, where they're just like, IT is garbage. It's a cost center, outsource as much of it as possible. And a lot of folks did that. And then you turn around 2011 or whatever, and it's like software is eating the world, and you need to be able to deal with all of that stuff internally because it's going to be part of your major part of your business. So we're still dealing with folks that are going through that flip, right? They were like, all right, they told us to outsource everything. We've all got MBAs, we outsource everything. That's what they told us to do. And I can make fun of MBAs because I have one, it's okay, it's all right. And in the meantime, now they're telling us we have to bring it all back inside and we have to learn how to do it all ourselves. And that's an incredible challenge for a lot of companies. So it's still hard to compete if you're outsourcing everything. We talk to a lot of folks, it's still really endemic, especially in insurance right now, the folks that we're talking to where it's still waterfall, it's still very old school, still all everything's outsourced, and there's still a lot of work that gets done in very old ways. So stepping back into what configuration management looked like before I had gray hair, the waterfall to agile era, right? How many people got beat down by agile transformations, right? You met way too many people who were Scrum consultants. They had been through PMI or whatever it is, and they come in and they had charts and they had boards and other things to help you out with. And at the time, as Waterfall was moving into Agile, we had, it was still very much something that was really good for developers. Like, as a sysadmin at this time, like, this is a very painful, very traumatic experience for me. Like, we had a lot of engineers, they were able to ship code to us every couple of weeks with maybe major releases a few times a year, but the things that actually needed to get done on the website weren't part of what they were working on. Was it easy to install? How did it affect the database? How were we going to install it? How well did it even run? Like, sometimes was completely ignored. So it really kind of stranded operators at the end of this cycle, where things were coming in pretty often, but weren't always thought about how good they were going to be when they got to production. And Agile kind of came from an era where a lot of software was still going onto a CD or a DVD, it was getting shipped out, and you're like, okay, the customer's gonna install this, maybe we'll send it a consultant and make some extra money to do that, but then when there's a problem, they're gonna call the help desk, and those guys aren't even in this building, right? They're in a different time zone from us. We don't really care what happens there. It wasn't a fully integrated sort of relationship. So they were able to install or ignore a lot of that stuff. So it represented a different kind of environment for configuration management. A lot of us who worked in very, very large environments, and so like 2006, 2007, I had like 1,200 machines that were just mine. And when I talked to people at the large installation systems administration conference, they're running 50. And I'm like, you kids these days, like, this is not enough at all. So still very, very small estates. And what constituted a large estate was still only a few hundred machines per sysadmin, per operator. So it becomes sort of a tipping point. Do you really need configuration management at this time? We never bought any at the companies that I worked at. We built some of our own stuff. It was all built in Perl, of course, because that was the tool at the time, and we knew we could get it everywhere. So the operators ended up writing the tools that we needed because that was sort of a cost platform that we could absorb at that time. The early vendors, and so this was early Puppet days, but CF Engine was kind of the major player, so there's much more academic roots in the things that they were doing, promise theory and some of the other research that Mark was doing, and was a much less, at the time we played with CF Engine a little bit and we're like, we're going back to our parallel library in Perl for this. It's like, it's cool, but not really what we want. So we moved sort of forward into the cloud era, and not everyone at this time went to cloud. The platform I was working on was just a massive internal, not sort of cloud, but it was all virtual machines. But the explosion of how many things you had to manage in order to sort of keep up with what technology was doing at the time was sort of the tipping point for sort of the value proposition for configuration management. There was finally enough to do and enough complexity in the system to warrant having to pay for something or to bring something in. So you have to sort of get over that not invented here sort of fear that a lot of organizations have before they'll bring something in. So you had a lot of virtual hosts, maybe they're on site or in your own data center, maybe they're in a managed service provider, which is a whole other nightmare sometimes. The applications were moving from everything being on one big machine that you bought special to being, I got these little machines, I sliced up this big machine into little VMs, and now it's like one application per VM sort of style. And there wasn't a lot of additional investment in personnel because we're working now in the economic downturn time. So 2009, 2010, not a lot of places that we were working with were hiring. So you're doing more work, there's more complexity, you're managing more things with fewer people, and the answer to that is always automation, right? And the configuration management space came into that. I arbitrarily named the next one the DevOps SRE era. Like, they sort of overlap, right? Because people were still sniffing around the cloud, because cloud's still scary for a lot of industries. But we also have these folks that are sort of moving forward into DevOps over the last 6-7 years, I guess, and the SRE stuff. And you can fight it out for definitions there, but looking more along the lines of, like, what is operations actually doing? What are they actually responsible for? And what does the tool ecosystem look like? And you have a lot more things that came onto the market, a lot more open source tools. But this time, Linux had pretty much eaten a huge amount of everyone's installed base, much to Microsoft's chagrin. So you had all these things that sort of came online at the same time. The large-scale operations and the sort of web operations sort of broke off from traditional systems administration, and it was an interesting fight to watch, because I was on one side and lots of other folks were on the other, and you know, things happened, and it was, some of them were mean, but it became sort of more of a set of disciplines and part of a practice that was geared towards managing these very, very large and in a lot of cases very transient systems that is incredibly different from what came from before. So CM in this time period, we started borrowing a lot more stuff from software development. Just different practices for sanity's sake, really. So things like revision control, the infrastructure as code that we used as our sort of marketing tagline for a while, and then our community led us down the testing path. We didn't really come out with that. We had a bunch of folks in our community that said, well, we're writing Ruby code for these recipes. We should be testing it like Ruby code. And they put a bunch of tools together for us to test things as if they were Ruby. And pulling in all of these additional practices and hygiene around writing good infrastructure code to manage these very large installed platforms. So it really started to modify the way we were thinking about it, the way the rest of the market was working with it. But it also, I think, in many ways, we didn't do a super good job of explaining this for the traditional marketplace. This was a time frame where we were selling a lot to enterprise, but getting this sort of workflow thing sort of set up and getting people comfortable with it, super, super challenging, and it's still challenging for a lot of places. So what happens in the future? Like, we don't know. We're watching containers. We'll see where they go, right? They're going to do stuff. They're going to be somewhere. It's fine. We'll figure that out. You can just grab CPU wherever you can find it, right? Like, serverless may work for some folks. It probably isn't for a lot of workloads just because of its nature. But it doesn't matter, right? At this point right now, there's a very, very small amount of code that's actually living in this life, right? Like, this is outer space, right? This is science fiction for a lot of folks, unfortunately, right now. And for everyone else, you sort of are still stuck in one of the other eras. They're all still in play, right? I'm still working with people who are migrating off a waterfall. It's great. It's like going back in time. So for this time being, we still care about configuration management. There's still a lot of organizations that we're talking to, that we're working with, that are learning that they have to do these transitions, but now, because they didn't do them 5, 10, 15 years ago, there's so much more. This is like when you're a little kid and you're fighting with your parents about your history homework or something, and you'd be like, well, there's so much more history now than there was when you were a kid because you're so old, right? There's so much more stuff now for them to pick from and choose from and look at and decide, is this going to work for my business? Is this going to work for my team? What investments do I then need to make on my skill sets for the people that work for me? Do I have a bunch of Solaris sysadmins that are hanging out in my remote office? And now everything in the future is going to be Linux containers in AWS, right? Like, those decisions are being made, you know, these currently, unfortunately. So you're transferring to newer practices. You have to get your stable foundations. We talk to a lot of folks where that's a huge part that's missing. We're building software faster, and that means having to have environments that match. And that's a lot of work if you're still doing things in a traditional way. Even if you're just working bare bones with sort of the cloud APIs, it's still a lot of work if you're still doing things sort of in an unautomated way. And a lot of things we're seeing with the workflow improvements and some of the other sort of I'll say cultural changes that are happening, is that configuration management itself and system automation and the sort of platform speed things that are happening are infringing a lot more on other parts of the dev cycle. So build and release kind of got adopted because you want a pipeline to do your infrastructure code, and you might as well put your application code in there. And now I've got like a Jenkins thing, and it's really cool, but it builds like all these transient dev test hosts, and then they pull down, and there's all this cool stuff that happens. So operations kind of like ate a little bit of build and release management. And we're seeing some of the other things get pulled in there. I think every big city now has a DevSecOps meetup or whatever to sort of bring security into the fold. So a big part of where we sort of lead in for folks is in investigating how they're building their dev cycle life, their life cycle environments. It's fascinating to talk to QA people about how this actually works in their environments. It's the first thing they will lead with. What's your biggest issue? I can't get an environment that looks like production. Like, it's a huge problem. How are you gonna publish good code to production if your intermediate steps are on sand, right? You need a solid foundation. So fortunately for us, that's a really good thing for configuration management to do. You just build up one place where you keep all of the definitions for your platforms, and you can use them wherever you need them. A lot of places a production operations team doesn't manage all of the assets across the lifecycle, which is totally understandable. You have operations that is still sort of, their cost center is still kind of linked with the production environment. QA has to probably, the product team pays for their QA environments and their dev environments. You have all these chargebacks and accounting and all these horrible things that happen. So the division of labor and accounting happens there. But you still want the code to go out on the on good environments. We're also looking at folks that are moving towards this continuous whatever, like it's deployment or it's integration or it's whatever it is. And as long as it's continuous as the first word, that's where we're headed. And it still requires, you know, culture and tooling to figure out how you're going to get all your stuff from idea to what does the customer think of it, right? There's still a lot of technology stuff, but also fuzzy human things that go into those components. And we're trying to help people thinking about always shipping versus we ship every now and then, or we release every year. And you're like, well, how do you fix bugs with that? And you're like, well, we talk about it, and then we escalate to the vice president, and like they decide if it's important enough. And sometimes we just turn that off. And you're like, that's horrible. Are you serious? But, you know, dragging them kicking and screaming into the 21st century with some of these things because their businesses are losing out on valuable dollars and resources. So you end up trying to automate as many parts of the pipeline as possible. And operations is pretty solid with this. A lot of the dev tools are getting better at this. QA is the place where we found that the tools aren't as good as they could be. The testing tools aren't necessarily automatable, or they require a lot more human intervention for approvals and things like that, but they're hopefully coming along. So we're modifying, or we're codifying and automating as much as possible. We're migrating away from GUI-based environments. The previous generation to our tool set was very much graphical interface things. Even some of the parallel generation stuff was very graphical, very pick and choose in a set of menus for the things that you wanted. And we are now trying to get everyone to treat as much of their platform definition or their infrastructure definition as code, so that if it's time to move off of this particular data center and put something maybe in the cloud, or you're moving to another data center or whatever, you can just pull things and redeploy them somewhere else. It makes it very, very easy. The message too about risk reduction, super interesting. You have smaller releases and more testable code. You have these traceable histories for all the changes that go through if you're making changes to your infrastructure that aren't in graphical user interfaces. It's hard to track what change you made when everything's in a GUI. we do work with some folks that are running in containers, right? And you know, the sort of joke is that, as I mentioned before, if you're running containers, you don't need configuration management anymore. You don't have to use that stuff. Unfortunately, it means you have to use it correctly. Like, you can't sort of half-ass the entire production cycle when you have these container environments. And I like to pick on the Java world, because I learned a lot of really bad practices that Java developers had a tendency to do, like retrieving builds out of the cycle and fixing a problem and then pushing them through with the same build number. And like, their tooling allows for that. And you're like, that's horrible. Why would you ever think that's a good idea? Like, they got partway through the pipeline and then you retrieved it and published it again with the same number. Like, that's horrifying. And stop doing that. But containers sort of force you into having better build hygiene and better platforms so these things will run. Docker is updating their software quite often, right? They're open source, it releases all the time. You want to know that I have a bug in my platform, it's fixing this thing. How do I get that out to the places that I'm running containers? Well, you put it in your chef recipe and push it out, right? So that you have everything that is needed on your platform. And we've sort of taken this step with build once artifacts with one of our other products now called Habitat, and I can talk about that a little bit. But what we're really driving people towards is this idea that your code is shippable in a permanent artifact, and that is a thing that lives forever, really, in your world. And that sort of mind shift, that change in thinking, comes after you've worked on solid platforms and you don't have to go in and tweak the environment because you forgot something or you have to fix something when it's already in the flow. We're seeing a lot more things moving to the left. We're pushing some stuff to the left as far as like security scanning and a couple of other things. Things that are late life cycle struggles pushing into a dev cycle because you can't bolt them on at the end. Performance is definitely one. You can't just go, well, we released it and it performs poorly. The page responds in like 75 milliseconds on mobile and the abandonment rate's like 85%. That's not something you want. You want to know that as early as possible. Security is a big push there. There's a lot of folks in the security world that are looking at how they can actually interact better with product teams and dev teams to get their voices heard in a way that is a little bit more positive. No one likes to get to launch time and discover that they're not actually allowed to put their code out. This was one that was big when I worked for an ISP. Like, the network was pretty locked down so that it wouldn't do any damage to the other thousands of things that were running. And we had one Java team, there's like, we're totally using unicast or multicast on this. And you get to launch time and the NetSec guy's like, no, you're not. What are you talking about? That's ridiculous. You're not running that in our network. And so you have like 6 months of dev time that's down the drain. So you want to push as much of that stuff up the chain as possible so that you don't get surprised later. So our game changer becomes rapid time to value, and configuration management plays a part in that in different places. We have, you know, managing your dynamic infrastructure, making sure that all the components that you have, whether they're in AWS or in your own data center on Azure or Google or DigitalOcean or wherever your stuff is, meet all the needs that you have. And we're using our infrastructure as code to automate as many of those things as possible so that our humans can do interesting human brain things rather than doing the same installs and user management and those things over and over. And add in a sprinkle of DevOps culture things to make it all go. So you get more innovation as well as increasing your quality over time. So we hope that configuration is there to help go fast, right? So whatever your platforms are, especially as Windows is still sort of lagging in container world and some of those things, bringing that stuff along with you as you build new products, ship new ideas, do different things there. So you can deploy your code as often as necessary, make sure that all your monitoring and metrics collection and all those things are in place when they need to be, and really minimizing time to market as much as possible with your automation. We also have configuration management as a component of failure. And this was a big thing that cloud pushed for us, was you have a much more lower barrier to entry for your ideas. You can spin up a machine somewhere else. You don't have to spend thousands of dollars procuring a machine and having it racked in your data center, having it linked to your network and all those things. So I have a request I put in, I have my credit card, I go to Amazon or whomever, and I have a machine that I can do these things on. So folks are starting to get used to spending less, dealing with new products and dealing with new ideas, just to get to the point of figuring out if they're good enough or not, and allowing them to still put those on configurations that they know are gonna work. Even if I'm experimenting in AWS and I know my production thing has to be inside my network in my data center, I can still use sort of the same profiles to ship things back and forth. And hopefully if I have really solid container build process, I'd run the same containers in both of those places too. A lot of folks aren't to that point yet, but they'll get there. It's an interesting place that I think serverless too will be interesting for how all this sort of risk assessment and ability to absorb failure and those sorts of things. You've got serverless, I've got like 40 lines of code and I'm gonna push it somewhere. Like it costs them nothing, right? So that is another interesting twist that'll come along. Also working towards lean, there's like 6 lean meetups in London. I was like, why do you need 6 meetups about lean? That's crazy. But lean's pretty easy to bring into a configuration management discussion, right? You're eliminating work that doesn't add value. So I have these very, very smart human sysadmins, and the work that I want them to be doing is things that require humans to think about, not I'm gonna install this RPM, I'm gonna add some users to this machine. Oh, I've got to delete the old logs. Like that's not human work. That's very scriptable, easy work. And that used to be the joke. Don't make me mad or I'll replace you with a very small shell script or whatever. Like we're beyond that. I want, even if I'm mad at you, you have work to do, right? Other interesting things about lean, doing continuous improvement, making your build pipelines faster, or making your release times narrower, all those sorts of things that come out with big efficiency improvements and all those sorts of things are still part of lean and how the system runs. Kaikaku is an interesting one where you recognize that you may need to completely overhaul the entire system at some point where it's really not working and just abandoning the whole thing. And that's an interesting one that's really, for IT at least, like. Works in with this sort of risk assessment and this ability to fail, where you can say this experiment didn't work, and that's okay, we learned these things about our customer base or our build process or whatever, and you turn it down and you move on. And it's much less expensive to do that now than it was 5, 6, 8 years ago. Configuration management and containers, we've played with several different options for what it looks like from a tooling standpoint, but from sort of a thought process standpoint, you really want to make sure you're managing all the things in your container ecosystem that are constantly updating. It's very, very nascent industry, part of the industry, and changes are happening all the time. And while I've stood here, they've probably done 2 releases in Kubernetes, right? Like things are constantly moving. So you want to keep up with bug fixes and making sure that all of your stuff that you require is up to speed and up to the good releases. And there's additional things that will come on board for what we've sort of been thinking about is the operations cliff for containers, where engineers are like, this is awesome, here's my thing, I've got this container, I can just run it. And then ops is like, wait, I've got metrics and monitoring and logs and all these things I need to worry about with this when I get it into production. How do I actually do that? And some stuff's working towards solutions and other things is just like, no one knows yet. So configuration management, we feel it's still a key component for folks that are working on IT modernization. And we have a lot of folks that are already going straight in, sort of modern, especially smaller startups. Even some of the mid-market now is coming on board with super modern practices. The whole thing sort of really been entwined with how the entire industry has moved from waterfall practices and releasing once a year and buying a lot of gear up front and having like a big reverse auction for the gear that you need for the year. And this year we bought HP, but last year Dell won. So like we have this big whole mishmash of things. And then there's still like these four sunboxes running this service over here, and it's, the whole thing's a huge mess. Fortunately, we've largely moved beyond that. But complexity can be super deceptive. Like, there's places where we've really thought that we've mitigated some complexity for something, right? And what we've really done is sort of shifted where the complexity lives. And we've seen this with our latest project, where we've been working on this thing called Habitat, which is application automation. So rather than operating system level, it's the things that just your application needs. And as we've been working with it, we're sysadmins, so when we were deploying applications before, you have like the list of RPMs that you need. And RPMs are great, like your DEBs or whatever your package system is. And for those of us of a certain age, we remember back to when things were published as tarballs or binary tars and all these things. And like, things were complex then, and we thought, oh, well, package management is going to solve all of this. And then we lived through an iteration of package management where you're like, this sucks. I need to download all these freaking dependencies, and it's completely insane. And oh my god, I don't even know where to get all these things. I go to RPM find, .net, of course, and figure it all out and download them all. And then Yum came along and some of these other tooling, and things are still complex under the hood there. Like, there's still a lot of wacky things that go on. You can still corrupt the RPM database if you're doing something really stupid. And there's then all the black magic that you need to fix it. And so we thought we had mitigated some of that stuff. And it happens in so many parts of the field where we think we've fixed the complexity, but really we've just shifted the way we're thinking about what's complex. And I think in some ways configuration management has done that. Chef in many ways is a complex tool, and what it was meant to do was help you deal with the complexity of not only having a lot of individual systems, but also having a lot of systems that don't match, and still being able to maintain some kind of sanity across those. Eventually, the human brain sort of conks out and says, I don't know anymore what I need for this Red Hat 5 box. I've just lost that part of my knowledge. And hopefully it's been replaced by a cat video or something. So I did learn a lot of lessons from past eras of sort of IT things. There's a lot of sort of now stuff that we sort of take for granted and hopefully will be part of the ecosystem, part of the life cycle as folks move into more containers, move into whatever looks like next, serverless, whatever it is. They take all this stuff with them that we all learned about in all these other places. So what does it mean for like us, for Chef, as a company? Like I said, we've been around now about 9 years. And most of our time, a lot of our engineering work is still spent with the core product, expanding our reach into different platforms. We support Windows very heavily, but we also support AIX at request of a customer. Fortunately, I don't have to do that work, so that's good. But there's a lot of things still going on in that part of the world. But in the meantime, you know, our forward-looking outlook really is that eventually this is going to be commoditized somehow. We don't really know what it's really going to look like. We have a bit of a hint. I mean, Red Hat bought Ansible. Like, something will happen there. Like, there will be some offering, I would think, in Satellite or in one of their product spaces that is the guts and DNA of Ansible, and like that's just going to be a commodity if you run a Red Hat platform. We stepped into AWS, so the OpsWorks components were always Chef under the hood anyway, but they were recently updated. Now you can run our commercial server as a service in AWS. You don't have to talk to us. You can go to AWS, instantiate a thing, and then you have all the components that you would if you installed it by hand, and that's great. So we know that is moving down a path to not being the most necessary component anymore. So we're looking at other stuff. And in spec, we moved into, we bought a company based in Germany in 2015. And they were doing a descriptive language for detecting variances in your compliance profiles. So if you're using the published internet security profiles or whatever they're called, you can encode those into InSpec code, run them against your systems and know, oh, I'm not supposed to be running this daemon. This port shouldn't be open. This user shouldn't be on the system at all. This user shouldn't have a home directory, any of the, any number of those obtuse things, and you can encode it and then run it everywhere. So sort of InSpec still being integrated into the Chef components, but as a standalone product, it's very useful across a number of different platforms, various Linuxes and Unixes, and then Windows as well. And then Habitat's our new kid, and we released this last year, and like I mentioned earlier, it's application automation. And it's a thing to really force the issue on how you build and maintain the application and its dependencies over time, and forcing you to be very, very clean about what goes into the application where it lives, its home, really. And what we found dealing with containers and some of these other platforms is that people have a tendency to bring everything. Your containers are very, very large. And Gareth Rushgrove mentioned this at Config Management Camp last month in Ghent. I guess it was earlier this month, that containers tend to be an entire virtual machine anyway. They're just running in container, and they're huge, and has everything in it, and you're like, why? It's because you don't know what your application needs because you weren't being careful when you built it. So backing up to the build process and saying, this is my application, these are exclusively the things that it needs, and I know that exactly. Part of Habitat's thing is a clean room. It's a very small busy box environment with nothing in it. It's like Bash and a couple of other tools. And you can say explicitly what my application depends on. So when it comes time to build an artifact out of it, I don't have to worry about shifting layers in a container or any kind of other weird things happening. I have exclusively the things that I need. And pushing that kind of direct intention, I guess you could say, into the early part of the build process is, it's been super interesting, nothing else, but it's something that I don't think a lot of folks were actually really realizing that they weren't doing. That it's super easy to go onto your dev box and tweak something. It's super easy even to go into QA and say, oh, well, they forgot this part, we'll fix it right here. Even if you have a few machines in production, okay, we'll fix it on the fly or whatever, and sort of add it into your chef scripts eventually or whatever you need to do. And sort of forgetting about, do I actually need this thing? Will it interfere with something else that's on the machine? And on the Windows environment, we used to have a lot of those, the DLL collisions and some of the other libraries that would stomp on each other, and something like this partitioning that Habitat will do in the future of containers, we hope, alleviates all of that stuff where everybody only has the things that they need. So that was kind of our step towards what things might look like in the future, where you only have the stuff you absolutely need. We know that this stuff's going to eventually go away. There's still a long tail of enterprises that are going to need this stuff for the next 5-10 years. But for the folks that are moving into the future, things that we really only need the little bits and pieces, that's where we're sort of pushing them. And that came in as sort of a change in product life cycles. Like I mentioned earlier, I have an MBA, and I got that in 2010. So like it's an internet generation since then, right? And they talk about old eras, we talk about buying cycles because we deal with enterprises, and they buy things every 5 years, and they buy a 3-year contract and a 2-year extension and all these other things. So the last time they looked at IT, it was a totally different landscape, right? If they last bought something in 2011 or 2012, like the world is like turned around 180 degrees since then. So there's a lot of different things that have happened since then. So the unfortunate side effect, though, is that technology executives, and I think this was in HBR, it might have been an info week, but they were talking about the shorter tenure of especially CIOs at larger organizations. Now, a large enterprise, especially banks, tend to have a lot of CIOs, but at the same time, these folks are only sticking around 18 to 26 months. So you're talking about a two-year tenure for someone who has a five-year buying cycle, and the environment that their customers are expecting is immediate response and very, very quick fixes. And none of those things match up. Nothing meshes. So there's still a lot of change that has to happen in the way organizations are thinking about IT before any of this other stuff goes away anyhow. But they do some of them will have an opportunity to skip things. Like we saw this the past couple of years where the people we were talking to didn't participate in the last generation. The things that they were currently running were two generations old. So they were just getting into thinking about API-driven virtual machine environments. And you're like, nah, here's this cloud stuff. Let's try this instead. And maybe skipping some things. Anyone that's coming out of a buying cycle now, they might have looked at cloud the last time they bought something, but they might have not, because at the time it was very scary. There wasn't a lot of sort of reassurances for large enterprise there. So yeah, damn, it's all tied together. Like, yeah, we sell software, but like we're also working with IT modernization and all these other technical practices. And we sell a lot to early adopters, certainly. Like Facebook, it's one of our biggest deployments. But they're also very much a unicorn based on our customer pool. We sell a lot to mainstream adopters. You think about sort of a product life cycle, which is like up in the long tail. And we have a lot of folks that bought early, and then we're still in sort of this upward post in a lot of parts of the market where they're just now getting to thinking about what we do. And then there's a lot more places where we're not even ready to talk to them. And I talked to the guy who just left earlier about networking equipment, right? And like, that's a place we can't even address. Like, that has to come from the vendors, and we've talked to them over the past couple of years, but there's a lot of specialized equipment and also a lot of very specific knowledge of regulations and things that have to go into their processes that we don't have the expertise for. So we're things like insurance companies, utilities, telcos, like that's a whole other crazy ball of wax when you're talking to those folks. And they're, yeah, far in the future for us to really even think about. So that's kind of where we are. So thank you for your kind attention. Now for the marketing part. We have a couple of events coming up. I know the trains do run. I took one tonight. We're doing a hands-on workshop next week. It's free at the Skills Matter in Moorgate. So we're doing hands-on Habitat, 3 hours of working through the product and the tool set and all those things. You just have to sign up online. Our meetup in London is the 13th, and I'm super excited about this talk. If you're into open source software at all, Guy Podjarny is the CEO at SNCC, and he used to work at Akamai and a couple of other places, but he does a talk about who owns open source security. So thinking about Heartbleed and some of these other things that have come out, and knowing that the software that was affected is run by volunteers, like how does that happen? Like how do you fix that? Do they have to like turn off their life? And they're volunteering for this project, and there's a lot of things that go into that. So it's a really good talk, and I'm super glad that we got him. That's the 13th of March. We're gonna be, our big community summit will be October 10th and 11th. And if you don't run Chef, we'll have a lot of Habitat stuff and inspect things there if you end up looking at those in the meantime. So we're at chef.io. All these events are listed on our events page. And if you'd like to learn Chef, we have a bunch of online tutorials. So. And if you want to come to Texas, you can come to Texas. That's where our conference will be. That's what I have. So thank you. Are there questions? So the question is, what's SRE? SRE is a site reliability engineer.
All right.
Yeah. And that was what Google named theirs. And a bunch of folks have adopted that moniker versus sort of operations or web operations or whatever. And the difference is negligible for most people. Charity Majors, I think, wrote a big screed about why it doesn't even matter and you should stop fighting about it. It was, yeah. What other questions?
The question was, from looking at various Puppet modules and kind of Puppet itself as well, it seems like it's an incredibly difficult task to actually test a configuration. And I've ended up writing my own scripts for it, which is ugly as anything. I'm wondering if does Chef take a different approach where you might have a bit more in-depth testing than just saying, oh, does my manifest actually run or not?
Yeah, so the question is testing in Chef versus Puppet. And honestly, it is easier in Chef, and that wasn't our fault. Like I mentioned earlier, our community folks stepped up and put that together. We eventually hired those people. There was a couple of efforts at different levels. So the first one was early days. It was called Spice Weasel, and that was really just making sure that your stuff ran. And then you had Food Critic, which was a little bit more testing of the actual code. So those went back like 3 or 4 years was our sort of our first things that did testing. And then Seth Fargo put together Chef Spec, which is built off of R Spec, which is a Ruby testing tool. So it's an additional library that you do unit testing with on your Chef code. And you can get incredibly detailed with it. But for integration testing, which is kind of what you want for deployments and things like that, we originally integrated with Server Spec. So that stuff is still out there. And then the InSpec stuff that we have now kind of takes its place. It's a little bit more extensible. But you plug it all together, like you can get a good workflow out of it with a tool called Test Kitchen. So that was written by Fletcher Nickel and actually runs with Puppet, although I'm not sure which tools it chooses in between. The Server Spec stuff probably does do Puppet in Test Kitchen, but I'm not sure what else, honestly. But that allows you to, it originally piggybacked off of Vagrant. So you're on your workstation, you fire Test Kitchen up, it launches a Vagrant box, runs your configuration management code, then runs your test code and says, oh, yeah, you have a website, it's running on port 80, it returns this code or page value or whatever and those sorts of things. So it's really built towards fast response, local development for infrastructure code. And that's what this sticker is. It's Test Kitchen.
Totally.
It looks, it's a potato or a bug or something, but it's Test Kitchen. Yeah. Any other questions? Awesome. Well, I have lots of stickers of our various things. If you'd like more information on Habitat, there's a card here. Our generic info card is here as well, so help yourselves. That stuff.
You have a lot of experience. You've learned a lot of things. And I think that's the thing, the takeaway for me anyway from today is that configuration management tools have learned a lot. They've been around and seen kind of what works and what doesn't work. And that's something that I feel is bad if we lose just because we run for the new cool tools. And the learning cliff with containers in production is super important because it works great in development, but it just never works in production.
Yeah.
So thanks very much. And I feel like you answered many of the questions.
Awesome.
I hope you feel the same. We'll be heading to the pub afterwards. Feel free to stay here, grab some more food, some more drinks. And next time we're meeting is 25th of April. And we call this event Human Ops. We'll be talking about the human side of operations. Hope to see you there.
Thank you.